morning. Welcome to Math 70. So, section 2.5 is all about infinite sets, right? That's kind of we talked first about the idea of one-to-one correspondence, about how you can use the idea of if you can find a one-to-one correspondence in between two sets. What does that mean? What does that tell you? If you could find a one-to-one correspondence, what conclusion can be made? Yeah. That those two sets have the same cardinality, right? Cardinality being the number of elements. Okay. So in effect, we can think of them, sure, as they're the same size, right? Having the same number of elements. All right. And so we looked at finite sets that had the same cardinality. We looked at infinite sets, and we had a little discussion about whether or not all sets that are infinite will have the same cardinality, right? We looked at the definition of an infinite set and looked at, again, I'll say it one more time, whether or not all infinite sets have the same cardinality. And I wasn't really telling you what the answer to that is. So, but today we're gonna discover that. Before we do that, though, we have to define something called a countable set, okay? A set is considered countable, okay, if it is either finite, right? So finite being the opposite of infinite, right? Or infinite and equivalent to the natural numbers. In other words, if a set is countable, then the set can be put into a one-to-one correspondence with the natural numbers or one of its proper subsets. All right, I'll give you a second to write all that down. So this idea of countable, right? A lot of times when we see a word that has, this prefix able, right, at the end, means able to whatever is the prefix or the root word, right? So able to be counted, right? So before you walked in here, if I asked you if something was countable, right? You might say, well, yeah, I mean, if I can say 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, right, or whatever, count how many things are there, right? But in math, that's not exactly the definition, right? That's true if it's finite, right? Because when you have a finite set and you count the elements in them, you end at some point, okay? So countable doesn't mean that you ever have to come to an end when you're counting something, okay? All it means is that in a theoretical world, right, you have this infinite set, you could say 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, and you go on forever and ever, right? So if you can make a one-to-one correspondence with the natural numbers or the counting numbers, even if it's infinite, we consider that countable, right? So again, we talked a lot about on Monday, the difference between humans being able to do something and theoretically being able to be done, right? So when we say countable, we don't mean that a human could ever do it, okay? So what we mean is theoretically it could be done, all right? Okay. So if we put it into a one-to-one correspondence with natural numbers, right, or one of its proper subsets, right? What are proper subsets of the natural numbers? What's an example of a proper subset of the natural numbers? Set containing what? Can you give me an example?
0 and 1, 2, 3.
Okay, good. It doesn't start with 0, though.
Oh, it doesn't?
No, the natural numbers actually starts with 1. Yeah, the whole numbers do, yeah. 1, 2, 3, right? Oops, not 1, 23. 1, 2, 3, okay? That's a proper subset, right? It's contained totally within, and it's not equivalent to the natural numbers, okay? So any proper subset, right, is going to end up being finite. Does that make sense? Because you have to cut it off somewhere in order for it to be a proper subset. So an example is this 1, 2, 3, or any finite subset of the natural number, right? Okay, all right. Now, yes?
What's the difference between a finite set of numbers and a proper subset of the natural numbers?
Like there isn't one.
So they're the same?
They're the same thing. Okay. Yeah, exactly. They're countable, okay? All right. Now, so basically the idea is you have finitely countable things, right? Which is any finite set, right? And then you have the idea of infinitely countable, right? So, but they're both considered countable. So down here we have, if a set is infinitely countable, right, we say that it has, this is a Hebrew letter. It's Hebrew. It's Aleph. Is anyone familiar with Hebrew a little bit? Usually I have one or two. Yeah. This is the symbol Aleph. It's the first letter of the Hebrew alphabet. And it looks more like, to me, like an N. Okay, which I kind of think is kind of nice because N for number, right? And then we put this little subscript down here, right? And the way you say this is Aleph naught, right? Or sometimes you hear Aleph null, N-U-L-L, right? Zero, zero for null, not elements, okay? So this is the amount of elements in an infinite set. This is the cardinality of elements in an infinite set that is infinitely countable, right? So if I have an infinite set that I can put into a one-to-one correspondence with the natural numbers, I say it has Aleph naught elements, okay? That's the number that's been given, yeah? It's a transfinite number. What that means is that it transcends infinity. It is the number of counting numbers. So on Monday, we were saying that there are infinitely many counting numbers, right? Right? We all agree with that. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, right? They go on forever and ever. Now what we're going to do is we're going to say that amount has a name. It's Aleph naught. Okay? Just like if we were to say the numbers 1 through 100, the counting numbers 1 through 100, there are 100 of those, right? That's the name, that's the cardinality of that set. Now we have an infinite set that has a cardinality that we're calling Aleph naught. Okay. Don't ask me how many Aleph naught is. It's not finite, right? I can't say that. It's an infinite set, right? Okay. All right. So I just want to say one more thing. If you want to try to write Aleph, it's not that easy. I just do like a squiggly N like that, which I realize is not very good. Aleph naught, yeah, is, we're going to say, a size of infinity. All right. On the next page, there's an example of a set that has Aleph naught elements in it. So let's take a look. The natural numbers is one set that has Aleph naught numbers in it. But here's another one. If I look at the set that starts at negative 12, yeah, and then keeps going backwards, right? Negative 18, then negative 24, then negative 30, and then keep going backwards, right? So what I'm saying is that this set, if I look at the number line, right, here's 0, here's negative 12, negative 18, negative 24. It's this number, this number, this number. The next one would be negative 36, right, and so on, right, and so on. putting all of those into a set, right? So I say dot, 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 keep going back. And then right here, I've described how you generate the elements of this set, right? So each one of these elements can be described using this as like a formula by plugging in the natural numbers. So what I mean is this, negative 12, the first number of the set, right? Or sequence. We kind of talked about this idea when we talked about sequences at the beginning of this. Was it the beginning of this chapter? I can't remember if it was in chapter 1 or 2. Okay, but so negative 12, right, is equal to negative 6 times 1 minus 6. Do you agree with that? Yeah? The next element in the set, negative 18, is equal to negative 6 times 2 minus 6. Negative 24 is negative 6 times 3 minus 6, right? It's 18 minus 6. So if I keep increasing these, right, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, and plug in every these are the natural numbers, right? 1, 2, 3. And if I plug them in to this little formula, negative 6n minus 6, you know, 1 by 1 by 1, I will get everything in this set. So the way that this is listed is a common way to list infinite sets. So I'll say go on and on and on, on and on and on. Because you're not able to list every element in an infinite set, right? But you can, if there's a mathematical, you know, something going on to generate the elements, you can list that mathematical formula, right, in general here, right? You can say, okay, we start with negative 12, negative 18, negative 24, negative 30, dot, 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 and all of them are of this form, negative 6 times n minus 6, right? As long as n is a natural number. So right here, and we just kind of make that assumption that n is an element of the natural numbers anytime we see a set or a sequence like this, okay? Okay, now I'm making a claim that this set has aleph not elements. Why? How do I know that? How do I know that this set has aleph not elements? Yeah,
Ashley. There's a formula?
Because there's a formula. Say more.
So then that way, going off the definition.
Yeah.
Like that there will be like a number of counting numbers. Formula.
Okay.
You have a formula that's proven, right?
Okay. Yeah, you're right. I want to kind of say it a little better. Maybe Angel can help.
I was just thinking that you don't have it set equal to anything.
We mean I don't have it set
so
equal to anything.
Usually a formula has both sides, and you just have like n, which could literally be anything.
Okay.
So I don't know. I was just thinking algebra. But.
Okay. Yeah, Monica.
For the definition of countable, it could be infinite and equivalent to natural numbers.
Okay.
So that means you could put in a one-to-one correspondence. So with negative 6n minus 6,
yeah,
you can put that in a correspondence with each one of the natural numbers.
Okay.
And so then it would be infinitely countable, so that's why it would be has aleph not elements.
Perfect. Great. Can everybody hear her? I want to say it again, but so the idea is we say it has aleph not infinite. Aleph not elements. Let's say our set. I'm just going to move it up so we have some space. Our set has aleph not elements since it can be put in a one-to-one correspondence with the natural numbers by the following. Right? If n is a natural number, then negative 6n minus 6 gives me elements of the set. I didn't name the set, so let's just say the set. an element. This is an element symbol, not an arrow. Right? The element of the set. So basically, I can take, it's just like what I said right here. I can take each natural number in turn, right, and plug it in to this formula, and that's going to give me every element in the set, right? It's going to get the number 1 will be paired with negative 12, 2 will be paired with negative 18, 3 will be paired with negative 24 through this formula, minus 6 and minus 6, right? And since I can do that, since I can put it into a one-to-one correspondence with the natural numbers, then our set is equivalent to the natural numbers, has the same cardinality, right? And aleph naught, aleph naught is the cardinality of the natural numbers. Of the natural, oh, I'm sorry. Let's just say of n. So it is the cardinality of our set. It's infinitely countable. That's another way to say it, right? If anything's infinitely countable, that means it can be put into a one-to-one correspondence with the natural numbers, which means it has aleph naught elements. Okay. And since I'm able to do that, put a one-to-one correspondence with the natural numbers in between, I'm sorry, with our set by using this idea, right? That means that this set has aleph naught elements in it. It's equivalent to the natural numbers. What are some other sets that are equivalent to the natural numbers? I'm just going to flip this over. Say, other sets that are equivalent.
Like real numbers?
To the natural numbers. Hold on 1 second, I'm sorry. Other sets that are equivalent to the natural numbers, or that we would say have aleph naught elements. Okay, so the real numbers. What are the real numbers? You said it, Johnny.
No, I know.
What are the real numbers?
I have to study.
Who knows what the real numbers are?
All non-imaginary numbers.
Good. So real numbers include all of the integers, the natural numbers, the whole numbers, all the fractions. All irrational numbers, like pi and the square root of 2 or whatever. Do you think we could do a one-to-one correspondence between the real numbers and the natural numbers? Maybe? No? Maybe? I don't know. I'm going to leave that one for a second. We'll come back to that. Okay? Think about a set that you would be able to make a one-to-one correspondence. That you would be able to make a one-to-one correspondence with the real numbers. Or, I'm sorry, with the natural numbers. That you could make a correspondence to.
Whole numbers?
The whole numbers. Okay? Yeah. Awesome. The whole numbers. What are the whole numbers?
0, 1, 2, 3.
Good. 0, 1, 2, 3, blah, blah, blah. Right? On and on and on. Okay? And we already made a one-to-one correspondence with the natural numbers, didn't we? Here? Yeah? So we say, if n is a natural number, what do we do to correspond each natural number with the whole number? So the first natural number is 1, right? If we want 1 to correspond with 0, what do we have to do? Good. We take n minus 1 to give us the whole numbers. Right? I guess I'll go ahead and write the natural numbers just so we have a visual of it. Right? So if I take every natural number and subtract 1, I get every whole number. So 1 minus 1 is 0, 2 minus 1 is 1, 3 minus 1 is 2, 4 minus 3 is, I'm sorry, 4 minus 1 is 3, and on and on and on, okay? All right, so the whole numbers are equivalent to the natural numbers. They have aleph naught elements in them. What's another set? We did another one in our notes on Monday. Look back at your notes, please. Rational numbers. We did the positive rationals, right? We could do the whole, all of the rational numbers using a similar idea. You end up, if you're going to do positive and negative rational numbers, you actually have to end up using like a grid that's got like four quadrants in it, right? Because we did all the positives as numerators and all the positive natural numbers as numerators and all the positive natural numbers as denominators, right? And you'd need to put the negatives too, and so you'd end up having these four. But you can go in like a little swirly pattern all around and around and around, similar, okay? I'll let you think about that one. But it will be true that the rational numbers, right? Those are fractions. And so the way that we made the correspondence between the positive rationals was not through a nice little succinct statement like this, right? It was through that, you know, going the zigzag pattern, right? Remember the zigzag pattern? So I'm just going to put a little note. I don't want to go back and do that again. Zigzag pattern through a chart of all natural numbers. I'm sorry, all rational numbers. All right. How about the integers? Remember, what sets are the integers? Or what set the integer is? Remember, we said it's an I, and I don't like how the book uses that. Starts negative, so all of the negative and positive whole, we can say negative and positive whole numbers, so no fractions in between. Do you think that this has aleph not elements in it? How do we make a one-to-one correspondence? Anybody have an idea where you, how you might correspond them? If you think you know, tell me which element there do you think corresponds with zero? Yeah.
Oh, I was...
I'm sorry, with one. The natural number is what I meant to say. First natural number. What are you going to say?
So I guess it could correspond with, like, the one of the proper subsets of the natural numbers where... Basically, like any of the positive integers.
Okay, so what you're saying is that the integers, but you've got it backwards. You're saying you could take a natural, you could take a subset of the natural numbers, right?
Or no, subset of the integers.
Okay, so if a subset of the integers corresponds with the natural numbers, then all you're saying is then that subset of the integers is equivalent, right? If you're trying to show that something is infinitely countable, right, or countable in general, that means that you would have to find a subset of the natural numbers to correspond all of these with.
Okay.
Does that make sense? You were doing it the other way. Yeah. Okay. So, anybody have any ideas?
Multiply it by its negative.
Okay. Maybe multiply it by its negative, like negative one. Is that what you're thinking? Yeah. So you would say then that you would take one and correspond it. So if you have, let's do this here. So if you have your natural numbers and your integers here, you're saying if you took one, then you would correspond this with negative one by multiplying it by negative one, maybe. And then negative two, negative three, negative four. Would this correspondence give all the net, all of the integers? No, you're going to miss all the positives.
You'd have to correspond it.
Yeah.
You did like A, if one set was like A and B, then you'd be like A1 times, like A1 times negative B, and then whatever B is. Then you take both negative and positive.
So you're saying, but remember, we have to do a one-to-one correspondence, right? So I can't let one correspond to negative one and one through two different formulas. Does that make sense? Because then you would be corresponding one to two different things. Yeah. What were you thinking, Manny?
I was thinking, I mean, if you're using negative 1, I mean, if you multiply negative 1 by negative 1, then you would get 1. So it would be the same, wouldn't it?
What do you mean
you
it would be?
If you have your, I guess not with the natural numbers, but if you started with the integers and you multiplied them by negative whatever they are, then you would, or negative 1, then you would get the positive form of it.
Well, if you took all the integers, right, and you multiplied them by negative 1, you'll just get all the integers again. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
It's just, they would just kind of like swap sides or something, right? Like negative 3 multiplied by negative 1 will give me positive 3, but positive 3 multiplied by negative 1 will give me a negative 3.
Okay.
So sure, you can make a correspondence between the integers and the integers. You ought to be able to do that, right? Because they're the same set. So the correspondence that you can do with the integers can't really be listed in a chart. It can't really be described by a formula. It's another visual kind of thing, just like with what we did with the rationals. So take a look at this list, right? Of integers. And my hint is that the natural number 1 will correspond with one of these, with 0. Okay, let's put it with 0. So here's my integers. Here's the natural numbers. I'm going to put a circle around the natural numbers. Yeah. I'm going to call this one number 1, right?
So this means that you can't do it?
No, I'm going to do it right now. Yeah. Okay. So the first integer, or correspond to number 1 of the natural numbers, is 0. What do you think we should correspond with 2?
Positive
1. Positive 1. Right, so we'll do that. Now if I keep going here, right, I'm never going to get to these. So maybe I ought to do what?
Alternate
back and forth, right? So like this one number 3, this one number 4, this one number 5, this one number 6, this one number 7, right? So does that make sense? I'm kind of going this way, then that way, then this way, then that way, right? Alternating back and forth, and so on, right? If I do that, will I hit them all? Theoretically, again, a human cannot do it, right? But theoretically, yes, all of them will be correspondent. All right, so your correspondence can be shown just like this, all right? So these are 3 sets that are equivalent to the natural numbers, the whole numbers, the rational numbers, and the integers. They all have aleph not elements, all right? So now I have a question for you. Do you think that all infinite sets are countable? Do you think we can put... Meaning, can we put them all into a one-to-one correspondence with the natural numbers? Another way to say that is, do all infinite sets have aleph not elements? I don't know why that elements is shoved down. It shouldn't be. It's a formatting error, okay? Do all infinite sets have aleph not elements? Yeah. Another way to say that is, are all sizes of infinity the same? Right. And another way to say that is, are there larger infinities or bigger infinities than aleph not? So there's a guy named Georg Cantor who was German, although I was reading that he was born in... I can't remember. I was reading it yesterday. Born somewhere else. But anyway, he's a German mathematician. His parents were German. He moved back to Germany, and that's where he did most of his schooling, so we consider him German. He lived from 1845 to 1918, and he made it his life's work to answer these questions. Yeah? These questions. Is there just one size of infinity, or are there more? Okay. And what he actually ended up finding out through his work is that there are actually infinite sizes of infinity. So you could think about aleph not being the smallest. He found that that was the smallest size of infinity. and that there are other sizes of infinity that are actually bigger, meaning that they have more elements in them. He put them into a sequence. I know, right? He put them into a sequence. He said, okay, there's Aleph naught, and then there's Aleph 1. Guess what he called the next size? Aleph 2, right? He got pretty creative with this. And then Aleph 3, and so on. Okay? So he said that he discovered, I should say, that there are an infinite number of sizes of infinity. So the answers to his all these questions are all infinite sets countable? No. Do they all have aleph not elements? No. Are all sizes of infinity the same? No. And are there bigger infinities than aleph not? Yes. And I'm going to show you how he discovered, I'm going to show you his proof that this exists, that aleph 1 exists, yeah, that it's bigger than aleph not. Right. So we already said that aleph naught is the number of elements in the natural numbers, right? That's how we defined it. Or any infinitely countable set. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to show you that aleph 1 is actually the number of elements in the real numbers. So Johnny, your idea of the real numbers was a good one. But it turns out that it does not have the same number of numbers as the natural numbers. That it's actually a bigger set, even though they're both infinite. So do you think is this an easy thing for you guys to understand, to grasp? Yeah, I don't know about you, but I can barely, I'm like, really, what? Right? Because if we think of infinity as going on forever and ever and ever, right? How can there be something bigger than that? And it actually, these kind of ideas, struggling with these ideas and working with this, actually drove Georg Cantor crazy. He actually ended his life in a sanatorium, they call it. You know, a hospital for people with mental illness. And he died there. Yeah. And there's actually quite a few, there were quite a few mathematicians at his time that thought he was just crazy, right? That even studying this kind of thing didn't make any sense, and why would you do this, and considered him crazy even before he really went crazy. And so I think part of that probably, you know, also contributed to the mental illness, because he was pretty shunned by the mathematical community. But it's turned out over many, many years, you know, since he died in 1918, that mathematicians have continued his work, and they've validated it, and it's actually added a ton of stuff to the study of mathematics and number theory and algebra. So he was right. Sadly, he didn't get to live to see that people now agree with him. Yeah, were you going to say something?
So aleph naught is the smallest form of infinity.
You got it. Aleph naught is the smallest form of infinity.
So
there's nothing smaller.
What is aleph 1?
I'm going to show you in just a second.
Okay. Are there smaller forms, too, of infinity?
Say that again.
Are they all smaller forms of infinity?
Or what all smaller forms?
Aleph 1, aleph 2, aleph 3.
No, they're larger 10. Forms of infinity.
Oh.
Aleph naught is the smallest one.
Okay.
Right? It goes like this. You could put greater than, you could put less than signs like this. Yeah.
And where does infinity fit in?
They're all infinity. You can no longer think of infinity as, like, anything infinite is the same, right?
Yeah.
They're all sizes of infinity. Think of it like, you know, the numbers that we know and love that actually are discrete quantities, that actually are finite quantities, right? They're all considered numbers, right? All of these are considered sizes of infinity. All right. And what's interesting is you can actually put them into a set, right? Talk about their subsets and their, you know, complements and their, all of that kind of stuff. And then one time when I was teaching this class, somebody asked me, well, how many of these are there, right? If there's infinite number of them, right? It turns out that there are aleph not of these. Right? How do I know that there are aleph not of these? You can tell by just by looking right there.
Zero.
Yeah.
So when I think of this, I think of it as a rope, like a thin rope that goes on forever.
Okay.
And the next level will be a bigger size rope, and then a bigger size rope.
Oh.
And then it goes on forever, but it also goes on forever that way.
But the smaller infinities are thinner, is what you're saying. And then the larger infinities are thicker, but they still go on forever.
Yeah,
that's an interesting idea.
They all go on forever.
Yeah, I mean, you can certainly kind of, I like that. You're thinking like dimensionally, right? So they go on forever and ever in two dimensions, but that third dimension is how you're thinking about making them larger and larger. You know, it's interesting that you say that because mathematicians actually use a word called dense to describe the larger infinities. Like we say that aleph one, or sets that have aleph one elements in there are more dense than these. And so the idea is actually, the idea is that there are more numbers in between the numbers, yeah? But it doesn't mean exactly that because think about this. So we said that the rational numbers, right, have aleph not elements in them, right? Fractions.
Rational numbers?
The rational numbers. We said that earlier on the last page, that the rational numbers have the same amount, right? And so, but the rational numbers, if I were to put them on a number line, right, like all the fractions on a number line, I'm not going to be able to figure out, like, what order they go in, yeah? Because if I take any two fractions, you can always find an infinite number of fractions in between them, yeah? It's true for the real numbers. So, and that idea is like density, right? You can find more and more and more. The more, further you look, as the rope gets thicker. But these both have that property. Yet one of them is smaller than the other. So I just want to throw that out there. Yeah. So somebody had their hand up too.
I just wondering, could you have aleph with instead of one or three aleph infinity? Does that exist?
No. I don't think so. Not that I know of.
It'd be the same thing, right?
It'd be the same thing, because infinity no longer is a quantity.
Yeah, okay.
Right?
Yeah.
The quantities are aleph not, aleph one, aleph two, aleph three. Four, right? These are all numbers, right? They actually are numbers. They're called transfinite. Right? Because they transcend finiteness, right? They're not finite. All right. So are you ready to see how he proved that there are more elements in the real numbers than the natural numbers? No. You're like, I really don't care. Okay. But either, I don't know, I think it's kind of interesting, right? So so we're gonna compare what we're gonna do is I'm gonna show you how there does not exist a one-to-one correspondence between the natural numbers and the real numbers. Okay. That's how we showed that things had the same elements as the natural numbers, right, had aleph not elements, by making a one-to-one correspondence, right, between the natural numbers and those sets, right, the set of integers or the set of rational numbers. But what happens when you try to do it with the real numbers is that it breaks down. That idea breaks down, okay, and in the following way. I don't know if you guys have a back of your page. Mm-mm. I need to type this part up, and I haven't done that yet. I don't always get to it every semester. It's not in the book, which I think is really dumb. Like, the book just glosses over it and says, and then Georg Cantor showed that there are an infinite number of infinities. And I'm like, wow, okay. All right, so here's the theorem, right? Is that the real numbers, right, which we abbreviate with R, have more or has, I should say, yeah, has, it's singular, has more elements than the natural numbers. Right? Even though they're both infinite, right? Which is the interesting thing about this. Okay, and here was his proof, and I have to credit him. Georg Cantor. Okay. This is what he did. He said, every real number, and just a reminder of what the real numbers are, right? They're the whole number, oops, not ho, they're the whole numbers, the natural, the rational, and the irrational. Right, all together in one set, can be represented as a decimal with infinite digits. Infinite digits. By the way, this infinity is alf naught. Okay, infinite digits. As such, right? Okay. So we're going to look at a couple of examples. So let's take one of, you know, a real number, like 3, right? If I wanted to write 3 as a decimal with infinite digits, I would write it as 3.00000000. Right? That makes sense? If I wanted to write the real number 1/2 as a decimal with infinite digits, I would write it as 0.500000. The rational numbers that repeat, clearly, have infinite decimal, infinite digits, a decimal representation with infinite digits. And even the real numbers that are irrational or don't repeat, right, can be written as a decimal with infinite digits. So every real number can be written this way. So what Cantor did then was he said, okay, I'm gonna make a list of the real numbers. Okay? I'm just gonna make a list of them. Okay? And I'm gonna try to pair that list of real numbers. Clearly, he's not able to humanly write a list of real numbers. Okay? He said, I'm gonna make a list of some of them. Right, and then say that list goes on and on forever, dot, 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 right? And I'm gonna try to pair them up with the one-to-one with the natural numbers, okay? So this is what he did. He said, okay, let's make a chart. Okay. Here's the natural numbers. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and here are my real numbers, okay? Now, real numbers can't be put in an order, as you can probably guess, because what comes after 3.00000 forever, right? 3.00000 forever, 1, 0, 0, you know, where do you put the 1, right? You can always move it, okay? So he just listed some random real numbers, right? Let's go ahead and use the ones we have up here. Why not? He's gonna pair the natural number 1 with the real number 3.00000. number 2 with 0.5000. Actually, I'm gonna add an extra 0 to these. Sorry. Number 3 with, you know, 1/3. Number 4 with pi. The next digit of pi is 9. And for 5, I don't know. How about 0.12121 blah 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 blah, and so on. Okay. So he said, this is a list of all the real numbers. They can all be written as with an infinite decimal expansion, we call it, and we can write them down. Okay. So if there exists a one-to-one correspondence between the natural numbers and the real numbers, we must be able to make a list like this. Right? So everyone agree with that? Pairing each natural number with a real number. Okay. Then Cantor said, Except here's a problem. Yeah? I can come up with a new number. I'm going to call it M, which I know is not on this list of real numbers, although it is a real number because it's going to have an infinite decimal expansion. But I can guarantee you, there's a way I can create a number that I'm going to call M that I can guarantee you will not be on the list of real numbers corresponded with a natural number. Okay? And you might be saying, what? How can you do that? It's a dot, 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 right? This is how it works, okay? What Cantor did was this, and this is where the ingenuity and, you know, many years of thought, you know, it's not like he just came up with this one day, right? He worked on this forever and ever and ever, and some people think he was, you know, well, he did turn crazy, but people thought he was even crazy in this, although it was actually quite ingenious. Yeah? This is what he did. He looked at decimal places of each of these numbers that correspond to the natural number that the real number is corresponded with. So this is what I mean. For the number, the real number that you correspond with natural number one, you take a look at the first place after the decimal. Okay. For the real number that you correspond with number two, with the natural number two, you look at the second digit past the decimal, right? Because remember, if you're talking about decimal places, you say the first, the second, the third, the fourth, the fifth, right? When you look at the real number that corresponds with the natural number three, you look at the third place past the decimal, okay? And so on. Is this making sense? So for four, here you're going to look at the fourth place. For five, you're going to look at the fifth place, and on and on and on, okay? And then you're going to build M by changing each one of these digits in some way, okay? This is what he did. He said, if the digit in the real number is not a 2, make it a 2 in your number M. If the digit in the real number, I don't have any two, is a two, make it a four. Okay. I'm going to add another number because I want to have a two somewhere. How about 6491132? Dot, dot, dot. I'm just adding one more number here to my list. So again, it's paired with number six, so I'm looking at the sixth decimal place. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Okay. All right. And so we're going to build M. Okay. You can put any number as the whole number part of M. Let's just put 0. It doesn't really matter. Put anything here. And we're going to write M out using this guide. Okay. So for the first decimal place past the decimal, we're going to look here. We're going to say, is this a 2? No, it's not a 2. It's a 0. So I'm going, it says, if it's not a 2, we're going to make it a 2 in the M. So I'm going to make my first place past the decimal a 2 because this first real number that's paired with the natural number 1 does not have a 2 in its first decimal place. Okay? Then we go on and on. How about here? Is this a 2? No. So I'm going to make it a 2. The next one, is this a 2? No. So I'm going to make it a 2. The third decimal place is not a 2, and the third number, so I'm going to make the third decimal place in M be a 2. Okay? And we'll keep going. The fourth decimal place is not a 2, so we make it a 2. The fifth decimal place is not a 2, so we make it a 2. Now our sixth decimal place is a 2, so what's this sixth decimal place here going to be? It's going to be a 4. And so on. All right? So notice what Georg did, right? You're like, I have no idea. He created a number. Remember what his claim was? His claim was that M is not on this list. How can he be so sure? And remember, this pattern continues, right? this pattern continues. It never stops, right? How can you be sure that this number is not on this list if you continue that pattern? Yeah, Elisa.
Because he's changing it no matter what he starts with.
Good. Because it's different than every other number on the list by one decimal place, at least. It could be other ones too, right? You say, well, M is not the first number because it's different by the first decimal place, right? And you guys know that if you have a different digit in your decimal place, in the same decimal place, it's a different number, right? So it's not the first number, it's not the second number, it's not the third number, it's not the fourth number, it's not the fifth number, it's not the sixth number, and we can keep going. It's not the seventh number, it's not the eighth number, it's not the ninth number, because it's going to differ by one decimal place by one decimal place with every number that's on this list. So this number M cannot be on the list. Hence, there's one more number in the real numbers than in the natural numbers. Because remember, this list, everything that was in this list was paired with a natural number, right? Yeah. So this one cannot be paired with a natural number. And he picked 2 and 4 to use for his proof, but 2 and 4 aren't really important, are they? You could pick 2 other numbers. You could just say, change it. Right? Just change it. You know, like if it's 0, just change it to something else. 8, 7, 6, 3, 9, 4, right? As long as it's not the same. Okay? So it turns out that by choosing different patterns, choosing different numbers, or just saying make it different, there actually is an infinite number of ways you can do that. You can make a new number, right? So he only had to show one, right? Because what was his goal? His goal was to show that the real numbers have more elements, the set of real numbers has more elements than the natural numbers, right? And so you only really need to show one in order to show that it's more, right? But you could keep doing it and there'll be infinitely more. So we're gonna just conclude this and say, M is not on the list of real numbers paired with the natural numbers. Thus, real numbers has at least one more element than the natural numbers. Since you can do this infinite number of ways, you can make infinite number of M's, it actually turns out that there are infinity more numbers in Aleph 1 than there actually are in Aleph Not. And so Georg Cantor said, okay, since I know that there's a bigger infinity than this natural number infinity, I'm going to call it Aleph 1. So he's the one who gave the name to all of these things. He called this the infinity of the natural numbers Aleph Not, and he called the infinity of the real numbers Aleph 1. The way that he found the rest is a similar argument, but it involves looking at sets of subsets of sets and showing that there's an infinite number of those. They're called power sets. I'm not going to go into that. But it's a similar argument. You make a list of subsets of a set. You make a list of the elements of a set and their subsets. And then you look at something called a power set and you show that there you can always create a different one. Okay? So it's the same idea. This is called Georg's diagonalization argument. It's very famous. Georg's diagonalization argument. Cantor's diagonalization argument. So in his time, he was considered crazy and even did go crazy. But today, everybody agrees with this. Everybody's like, oh yeah, there's different sizes of infinity. And his work has a lot of applications, especially with physics and astronomy today. Trying to look for a unified theory of everything actually plays in quite big into that. All right. If you're interested in Georg Cantor, he's a very interesting guy. I would recommend doing, you know, a Google search and just reading a little bit about him on Wikipedia. It takes 5 minutes. Wow. What a crazy person. But without him, we might not be able to figure out, you know, what our universe is for us. All right. Does anybody have any questions? I in no way will expect you to recreate this proof. Okay. That would be insane. Garrett Cantor worked on it for years and years and years, okay? And I know, you know, that's not your life's work, okay? But it's pretty interesting to see. All right, so that concludes our study about set theory and sets, okay? We are going to have a test, as I mentioned, on Monday for chapters 1 and 2. Chapter 1, if you recall, you're like, what is chapter 1 about? It was all just about problem solving, right? We talked about inductive and deductive reasoning, right? And then solving some problems. It had sequences in it. Yeah. All right, so what I'm gonna do right now is I'm gonna pass out, this is the exam 1 that I gave last fall, okay, in this class, which was the first time I was teaching from this particular book, okay? So it's a, you know, I have tests from other semesters, but it was a different book, and so they're not probably as good of a guide as to what your test might look like. Yes, sure, there you go. All right, so I'm gonna get these passed out. Put a disclaimer out there, right? I'm not saying that these are the only things that will be on the test, okay? But this is something that it looks kind of like. Oh, we need another one back there. Sorry. When you're studying for the test, be sure to study the quizzes that we've had, which have only been 2, I guess. The homework, right? And the notes from class, okay? So make sure that you feel very comfortable with all of those things. But I did want to pass this out because I know that this class is a little bit, feels unknown, right? Like, what are you going to ask us? It's not like our regular math class, okay? Like, I shouldn't say regular math, an algebra class, okay? So anyway, let's kind of take a look at these to refresh our memory about what chapters 1 especially and chapters 2 hold in for us. And then I also have an answer key to this that I'll give you at the end of the period. But I kind of want to look at it without the answer key, you know, to kind of remind ourselves and think about, you know, maybe what are the solutions to some of these before you look at the answer. If I give you out the answer key right now, you're just going to read the answer. Look at it, read the answer. Right? And ideally, you should, you know, challenge your brain to recall some things first. Okay, so let's take a look at question number 1. It says, is the argument, I usually pass math tests, so I will pass this math test, an example of inductive or deductive reasoning? Do you remember? What's the difference between inductive? Okay, Rose, do you think you know?
I think it's inductive reasoning.
Okay, what is inductive reasoning? Can you tell us?
It's when you use like examples or a guess and check to solve a problem.
Okay, so you use previous examples, right? You see results from previous examples and then you say, oh, this must always happen then, right? What is deductive reasoning? Somebody else? Do you remember what deductive reasoning is? Yes, Imre.
Through like a proof almost. Like you apply it in order to execution of a premise. Right?
Okay. Yeah. Well, they're both executions of a premise, right? I mean, you're both.
We're talking about deductive, right?
Deductive.
Yeah. Yeah.
You don't use just previous examples and then say, oh, it must do this because everything else in that same situation did this. What do you use to reason deductively? Formulas, right? Some kind of, it doesn't have to be a formula, but some kind of, I'm missing the word. Procedure, right? Some kind of a procedure that's defined, right? So anyway, okay. So. Do you guys think she's right? Is this inductive? Yeah, definitely, right? You're definitely not applying some kind of procedure, right? A way to reason about this deductively, right? How would you reason deductively that you will pass a math test? What's a procedure you could use? Not that, maybe it's not that easy, I don't know.
Percentages are your chance of passing a math test.
Okay, good. So on my test, I always tell you how many points everything's worth, right? So a procedure that you could use deductively is to go through and think about, like, did I get this one right? And if I did, I'm going to get the points and then add up all the points and divide by the total number, and then you'll have a good idea about whether or not you passed, right? Something I recommend you do when you take the test Monday, right? Pay attention to the point values, right? Okay. All right. Let's look at number two. Find the third, fourth, and fifth terms of the sequence defined by a sub 1 is 2, a sub 2 is 3, and then a sub n equals a sub n minus 1 plus a sub n minus 2 for n greater than or equal to 3. Okay, so we know the first two terms, right? We know that a sub 1 is 2, a sub 2 is 3, right? And I want you to find the third, fourth, and fifth terms. So a, that means find a sub 3, a sub 4, and a sub 5. So how do we do this? What should I put here next to a sub 3? A sub 3 minus 1 plus?
A sub 3 minus 2.
Right, good. So I'm using this right here, this a sub n formula, right? And remember this n corresponds to these little subscripts, right? And this n is the same as these n's, right? So a sub 3 is going to be equal to a sub 3 minus 1 plus a sub 3 minus 2. Well, a sub 3 minus 1, 3 minus 1 is 2. So that's a sub 2, and 3 minus 2 is 1. So I'm going to add a sub 2 and a sub 1. Well, luckily, I know their values, right, because they were given to me by the teacher. I would have to do this. You wouldn't be able to do it unless you knew those. So you'd say, well, that a sub 2 is 3, a sub 1 is 2, and so that's 5. Okay. 2, 3, 5. What is this really saying? What does a sub n minus 1 plus a sub n minus 2 mean? What two things are you adding in terms of the sequence? Yeah, Danielle? The previous two terms, right? So you don't even necessarily, if you could see that, you wouldn't even necessarily have to write this out as a sub 4 minus 1 plus a sub 4 minus 2. You know, you could just say, oh, look, we got that by adding 2 and 3 because a sub n minus 1 is the previous term before a sub n. A sub n minus 2 is the previous one before that one. So you would know then that a sub 4, you could just take 5 plus 3 to get 8, right? And then a sub 5 would be 8 plus 5 gives you 13. This is similar to the Fibonacci sequence, although not identical.
Can you repeat that?
Repeat
the
how we got this?
Yeah, so why would you take, like, the explanation behind the previous term.
Sure. So when I see, if I this is telling me that a term, a sub n, any term, equal to a sub n minus 1, right? So n minus 1 is 1 less than n, right?
Okay.
So that means that a sub n minus 1 is the term right before a sub n.
Right. Oh.
And a sub n minus 2 is 2 less than n. So this is the term that's 2 before a sub n, right? So it's saying find each term by adding the one before it and the one before that. Yeah. So then here, I know then that that's 5 plus 3. Feel free to plug it in every time. You don't have to, you know, see that. But if you do, you know, if you are reading this and you see, oh, this just means the one before and the one two times before, feel free to just use, you know, use that. Yes?
Would you consider that, like, showing your work?
I would. I would consider it showing your work, absolutely. Because you would, yeah. There's no other way you could get the 5, the 8, and the 13 without doing that, right? I mean, that's how you get them.
Yeah, but I mean, like, if you notice the pattern.
If you notice the pattern.
And then just for, like, A4 equals 8, A5 equals 13.
Yeah, that'd be fine with me. Mm-hmm. All right. Okay. So that's in chapter 1. How about number 3? Use deductive reasoning to find the cost of a shirt alone. If a shirt and tie together cost $50, and the shirt costs $30 more than the tie, oh no, algebra, right? Deductive reasoning? Do you remember doing, we did a couple like this in homework. So we have the cost of a shirt alone and the cost of a tie.
Like substitution.
Yeah, we're gonna do a system, right? So if we let X be the cost of a shirt and Y be the cost of a tie, right? I know that the shirt and the tie together cost $50. And I know that the shirt costs $30 more than the tie. So we could say X is Y plus 30. And then I could just plug this in. This is equal to X, Y plus 30, so I can plug it in for X. So we say Y plus 30 plus Y is equal to 50, right? So the Y plus 30, this is the shirt. And this is the tie. So you could do it using systems, or you could just, you know, do this right out. Right? You could just say, oh, I know, take the tie plus 30, add the tie again, and it gets me 50. So this is 2y plus 30 equals 50, which means that 2y is equal to 20, hence y is equal to 10, right? And it asks me to find the cost of the shirt. So Y was the tie, $10 for the tie. How much was the shirt then? 40, right? Because shirt and tie together cost 50, so $40 for the shirt. So this is the final answer, okay? So that's a procedure, right? You don't have to use that particular procedure. But that is one. All right, one more thing from chapter one, roster notation. Wait, I don't know if chapter one. No, this was in the very beginning of chapter two. Because chapter two is all about set theory, right? And we talked about different kinds of notation. What's roster notation?
Writing it out like in the problem, just say -4, -3.
Okay, good. So just a list, right? So roster would look like this, the set of integers between -4 and 4, including -4 and 4. So -4, -3, -2, -1, 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, right? Roster is just making a list. Useful for finite sets that are small, right? Once they get too big or infinite, it doesn't help so much. So we could use set builder. Does anybody remember what set builder notation looks like?
Isn't that like X is
such that. Yeah, you got it. This idea of such that it's all X, such that, let's see. How could we describe X?
Is there less than?
Greater than?
-4, less than.
You're equal to 4, but we also have to say that X is an integer. X is an element of the integers, right? Because if we just say X is between -4 and 4, we're including, you know, all the fractions and stuff in between. So there's a set builder. Also, just feel free to use, when you use set builder, to just use English, right? You could say something that, like, I'll say, or all X such that X is an integer, X less than or equal to -4, you know, something like that. That's totally fine too. Okay. You can even say this part in English, right? X is greater than or equal to -4 and less than or equal to -4. Okay. It's never wrong to use full complete sentences to describe mathematical ideas. Ever. Never wrong. Okay. We do it all the time. The symbols are just shorter. They're not more correct. All right. Now, starting with number 5, yeah, we really get into the idea of equivalent sets, equal sets. We don't have time to do all this. How many subsets do we have? List proper subsets. Fill in, remember the difference between element and contain and subset, right? And then on the back, there's the Venn diagram thing to show that two sets are equivalent. Define infinitely countable, two examples. And what does a one-to-one correspondence mean? All right, so before you leave, make sure sure you get an answer key, okay? So my suggestion, advice to you is to work through that without looking at the answers. See if you can answer them all, okay? Then check your answers. If you can't answer them all, there's parts, those are definitely parts that you need to study, yeah? In addition to the quizzes and all the notes, okay? All right. Okay. All right, I'll pass this out and I'll see you on Monday.